Generally, we think the cost of innovation is collapsing here.
It is going to transform our lives. We're going to look back and see this is a hugely important era.
This is obviously the most disruptive technology in the history of mankind.
At the center of many of the latest AI breakthroughs are large language models, or LLMs, the ChatGPTs and Geminis of this world. But as powerful as they are becoming, we learn more every day about their limitations, how they can be prone to errors, hallucinations, and uncertainty. One of those trying to address these limitations is none other than Vlad Tenev, known to most of us as the CEO and co-founder of Robinhood Markets. Tenev has become a successful entrepreneur, but his background is in mathematics.
What a lot of people don't know about me is actually before I became an entrepreneur, I was a mathematician, or at least an aspiring mathematician. I always had this passion for mathematics and for advancing our understanding of reality. And so when we saw GPT-4 come out, along with a bunch of improvements in the mathematics community around formal verification, Tudor, who's my co-founder and CEO of Harmonic, and I got very, very excited about building something. We thought that the time was right to actually build something in mathematics that combined the state of the art in that field with the state of the art in AI.
Tenev's new firm, Harmonic, hopes to achieve something that still belongs to the realm of science fiction. Beyond artificial narrow intelligence like ChatGPT, which can perform specific and limited tasks, beyond even an artificial general intelligence, which could learn and adapt like humans, Tenev says his goal is to help create what he calls a mathematical superintelligence.
So mathematical superintelligence is artificial intelligence that can reason and solve math problems at a level exceeding the most advanced mathematics researchers, so professional mathematicians that are out there today. And we think that developing such a system will not only greatly accelerate the progress of mathematics, but it'll also accelerate progress in all fields of science and technology that depend on mathematics.
We have heard at this point so much about large language models in the AI space. What you describe sounds like almost the obverse of large language models, which, as I understand it, operate on language rather than on numbers or on mathematics.
I think the main problem with large language models and AI systems as they're currently designed is that they very, very confidently can tell you the wrong thing. So there's very few controls over what we call hallucinations. You'll ask a large language model a question, it'll give you an answer. You can ask it to solve a major mathematical conjecture and it'll spit out output. And it can be very convincing in its incorrectness. And so I think that's a huge problem. And that's by and large what's hindered the adoption of these AI tools in mission critical industries. And the way that Harmonic has designed our AI from the beginning is with correctness and verifiability being a first class citizen.
Last year, Harmonic closed a $75 million Series A funding round led by Sequoia Capital and announced that its AI had performed well in a test of mathematical reasoning. But Tenev says there's still work to do before true mathematical superintelligence is achieved and before Harmonic can roll out a product to consumers.
We're still in fairly early stages, but we're actually getting close to unveiling our technology to the public. So the team actually released a big result about 9 to 12 months ago where we showed really tremendous advancements across a few key mathematics benchmarks that were focused on formal mathematics.
Give us a sense of that development process. I mean, are you working toward a prototype or do you have a prototype already?
We have some things internally that we're refining. And basically, the company is largely focused on research because without a strong model that keeps getting better and better, it's not as useful. But over the past few months, we've started to turn more and more of our resources towards commercialization. and actually figuring out how we're going to put it into people's hands, who the customers are, what the biggest pain points we can help solve for customers are.
While Tenev and his colleagues walk the long and uncertain road towards superintelligence, Jack Hidary has built a business around what he calls large quantitative models, which are trained on numbers and data rather than on prose. His company, SandboxAQ, spun off from Alphabet in 2022.
What we can do is we can take the equations of biology, of chemistry, of physics, of engineering, and we can train an AI on those. And that's the world now of large quantitative models, LQMs. And this world of LQMs impacts 80% of our economy and drives massive innovation in the companies that use them. And so you have large language models on the one hand, and from a business point of view, they're mainly there to cut some costs. If you have, say, $30 million of costs every year in your company, you could probably start lopping off 10, 15, 20 million of customer service costs per year. And that's going to be a great savings for your company. But when it comes to creating new product, billions of dollars of new revenue, that's not really going to be a large language model. That's going to be an LQM, a large quantitative model.
Where are we in developing LQMs?
LQMs are now proliferating in the B2B land. So it's less about consumers using LQMs, but it's really about businesses using LQMs. And right now, we announced at SandboxAQ that we're working with Sanofi, for example, a top 10 pharma company, using LQMs to advance their work in life-saving medicines. We announce work with chemical companies such as Aramco using LQMs to upvalue the hydrocarbons coming out so we can create new products, products that will not be burned in the atmosphere, but rather be put into various kinds of vehicles and others to lightweight and to add value to those industries as well.
There's a lot of money being invested in AI right now. A lot, hundreds of billions of dollars literally being invested. From what you understand, where are the places to look for good investments? Or even better, what would you advise an investor to look out for, both on the upside and the downside, in considering investing in AI?
There's two real ways to play the AI future. One is to focus on a number of mainly private AI companies that are out there now, and you know, various people and various banks are able to put together vehicles to invest in these. And so that's one way to really focus on that. The second is to look at the public markets. And we look at the public markets, again, you can look at the hyperscalers such as Amazon, Microsoft, Google, and others, and you could, you know, place your bets there, because essentially those are AI-driven companies at this point. But another way to make your AI play that actually may be more fruitful is to look at industry by industry, David, and understand who are going to be the AI winners and AI losers in the pharmaceutical industry, in the energy industry, in the telco industry, in the financial services sector. Each of these are $8, $10, $15 trillion sectors. And the winners and losers there are going to really determine billions and billions of dollars of value of market cap difference as those two groups diverge. The winners who are embracing AI and the laggards who are not embracing AI fast enough.
Whoever the winners and losers might be tomorrow, picking them today is anything but certain. MIT professor Alex Pentland says there will be no one-size-fits-all solution.
I think it's pretty clear that different AI will be used for different purposes. It's just like humans are expert in one thing or another. You want to have as much sort of information and depth in something like designing drugs or so medicines or doing climate change as you possibly can. Your climate change model doesn't need to speak 20 different languages, so don't waste the power of the language by training on that sort of thing.
You have a deep understanding of artificial intelligence, and you are an academic. I'm not going to ask you for investment advice, except I am. Here at Bloomberg, there's an awful lot of money, tens of billions, even hundreds of billions of dollars going into artificial intelligence. Where should investors be looking to really put money into artificial intelligence, or should they just be trying a lot of different things, hoping something pays off?
Well, if you're actually a qualified investor so that you have enough money to sort of spread it around, I would stick with things that have a very clear, defined business case. So I mentioned accounting, right? Or say taxes. Intuit is worth a lot of money because it uses AI to help you with your taxes. Clear business case there. So look for other things like that, for drug discovery, for risk evaluation, things like that. One thing not to do is assume that whatever it is that they're building, this AI that they're building, will never make mistakes, because it will. Everything makes mistakes sometimes. And you have to make sure that the thing that you're doing, when it makes that mistake, doesn't bankrupt the company.